This is a moment you wait for. You'll be searching in the dark, your sweat soaking through the floor. Buried in your bones as a need that you can't ignore. Taking your breath, stealing your mind, and all that is real is left behind. Don't fight it, it's coming for you, running at you. It's only this moment, don't get walking back to life. Your fever dream, can't you see it getting closer? Just surrender, catch a feel, a feel, and take it all. It's fire, it's freedom, it's wide open. It's a preacher and a pulpit, and you're by the motion. Something breaking and the brick of every wall, it's open. Tonight, 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 tonight,
Good to see you, yeah. Look at these boys. I saw these guys just before the show. I don't stand up for a sec. I don't know if you can see this. They made a t-shirt. Can you get a shot down there? Stand next to it. Look at that t-shirt. No, don't move. They've got them. Hand drawn by Cam. Cam and Brendan. That's Ryan Reynolds and me. Came all the way over the other side of the world to get away from Ryan Reynolds. He's here. How you doing today? I'm so happy to be here. We've just been traveling around UK, around Europe. We've been all around America, but I'm finally home in Australia. It makes me so, so happy. Thank you. I want to hear from you if you're at the back two rows, just the back two rows. I want to hear from you. First four concerts I ever went to growing up in Sydney, Sydney Entertainment Centre. The only tickets I could afford were in the back two rows. I love you guys. Thank you so much for being here. It means the world to me. How you doing? Welcome. You haven't missed much. It's okay. We did the whole Greatest Showman soundtrack. I'm going to move on to some other stuff now. Oops. So, here's something you don't know about me. I'm really good at numbers. It's something I'm really good at. I'm not like a mathematical genius, but I remember numbers. I can tell you numbers. I'm not just talking today's date, August 17th, 2019. No. I can tell you that Melbourne, I don't know if you know this, Melbourne was the capital of Australia from 1901 to 1927 until Canberra was established. Did you know that? You did? Funnily enough, they didn't teach us that at Sydney Public School. You admitted that one. I can also tell you that Victoria is the dog capital of Australia. 900,000 dogs in the state of Victoria. Which also equals 9 tons of dog poo every single day that we picked up. But I can go way back. I can tell you my first home phone number, 440-8882. I can tell you my first license plate on my number car. I was thinking, license plate's American. Number plate. My number plate on my car. Hey guys, how are you? JDC397, second one, KSK071. I can tell you tonight, today, we have 193 total crew, 10 singers and dancers, 20 musicians, 50 choir members, 2 acts, 1 interval, 20 minutes long. Am I good at numbers or did I just remember that line? I can also, do you also spend a bit too much time dwelling on numbers? Like, you know, like the football score, your cricket score, interest rates, bank balance, heart rate, blood pressure, your age, no, flu, no. I do. Are you the type of person to leave a show 10 minutes before the end just to beat the traffic? I am. I'm one of them. So here's the deal. In case you are just being quiet, you're a bit embarrassed, here's the deal. I will warn you 2 songs before the end so you can just, no judgment from me. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. That was a really weird woo-woo, whoever's doing that. Okay. Sounded more like Thomas the Tank Engine. Here's what I'm really bad at. I'm terrible at saying no. Really bad. It's shocking. Good enough. Melbourne. I am good at saying no to that. You don't stay married for 23 years unless you get good at saying no to that, trust me. So, but when you start off as an actor, it doesn't matter because you literally say yes to everything. Like when your agent calls you and says, Hugh, can you like tricycle on a high wire? Oh yeah, done it my whole life. I love it, I love it, I love it, yeah. Can you jump out of a plane? Yes, love jumping out of a plane, yeah. Can you audition for a musical even though you've never sung before? 100%, yes, and I did. I auditioned for the role of Gaston in the stage production of Here in Melbourne. And I had 4 weeks before the audition, so I figured, it's all right, I'll just go and get some singing lessons. How hard can it be, right? Yeah, turns out it's pretty hard. And I was really, really bad until the very final lesson, right? And I walked in and I said to Martin Croft, who was my singing teacher, I said, Martin, you sing it, right? And I'll just copy you. I will literally mimic you. And he sang it, I did, and he was like, that's perfect, and I got the part. That was it. When I was a lad, I ate 4 dozen eggs every morning to help me get large. But now that I've grown, I eat 5 dozen eggs, so I'm roughly the size of a barge. In a wrestling match, nobody fights like Gaston. As you see, I've got biceps to spare.
But I'm strong and scrappy
and strong. That's right, and every last inch of me is covered in hair. I did this 400 times, love it. Here we go. Very good year for me, 95. That was the year I met my wife, Deb. Melbourne girl. Yeah, I've got good taste in women. Now, I'm a really, really indecisive person. You know, like, you don't want to be my waiter. It's a nightmare. It takes forever. But a few times in my life, I've known things very, very clearly, like almost immediately. And one of those was Deb. I just knew in my bones, like 2 or 3 weeks into dating, I just knew we were going to spend the rest of our lives together. I knew it. She did not know it. Let me be very clear. let me give you an example of my relationship with Deb. So, have we got any Wolverine fans here today? Yes? Yes, I hope you're not only a Wolverine fan. It could be a very, very long day for you. I know when I say Wolverine, a lot of people think of this. That's how I get out of the bath every morning. It's easy to think of the 9 movies or the 17 years, but let me take you back to the very beginning, X-Men 1, okay, 1999, 5 weeks into shooting, and I was on the verge of being fired. The head of the studio flew in, pulled me aside at lunch, and proceeded to tell me that they were worried. At the studio, he said, we're just not seeing on camera what we saw in the audition. He said, it's like there's a lampshade over the light.
And the very next day, the director pulled me aside and gave me the exact same speech, right? Including the lampshade over the light metaphor, the whole thing, right? And clearly they'd been talking, and I figured, oh, I see, this is the talk you get. This is like getting the letters, first letter, second letter. And I was like, oh, in Hollywood, it's just a talk at lunch. And I was freaking out, and I went home to Deb, and I was just whinging, like Olympic level whinging to her about everything, you know. And this was the biggest break of my career by a mile, and I was just really worried, and I was complaining about everything. And finally, after listening to me for about an hour, and patience is not her strong suit, anyone singing knows that, she just said to me, "Babe, trust yourself. You're just worrying way too much about what everybody else is thinking. Focus on the character. Trust your instincts. You got this." And she was right. Of course she was right. But you know, to me, that is love, right? Someone who believes in you, even when you don't really believe in yourself. And this whole show is dedicated to Deb and the kids. But right now, I would like to sing the song to which we had our first waltz at our wedding.
When somebody loves you, it's no good unless she loves you. Deep it goes if it's real. But if you let me love you, it's for sure I'm gonna love you all the way, all the way.
Now, if I ever want to describe Deb to someone who has never met her, I always tell the story of the two of us at the Peninsula Hotel in Los Angeles. We were having lunch in a very, very swanky restaurant in the lobby. And we were sitting in one of those booths, you know, when you sit next to each other. And on the other side of the restaurant was a tall, dark, smiling man in an evening suit and a bow tie. And he was staring directly at Deb for a long time, right? And I didn't know who he was. And I looked over at Deb, and Deb is staring at him too. And she has this look on her face that I've seen many, many times before. It's a look of panic. It's that, oh, I know this guy, I've forgotten where I met him, oh, what's his name, this is so embarrassing, please don't come over, please don't come over. And he starts coming over, right, directly towards us. And just as he goes to reach out his hand, Deb can't take it any longer, so she just leaps up out of the booth, gives him this massive hug. "Darling, how are you? How's the family? How are the kids? So good to see you." Well, there's a really, really awkward silence as they part, because the guy just kept reaching his hand towards the table to pick up the plates, because he was the waiter.
It's no good unless she needs you all the way through the good old years and all those in between years. Come on, me. Who knows when love will lead us? Only a fool would say.
Points there, appreciate that, thank you very much. Hey, how you doing? Good to see you, man. Yeah, I see a few of the guys, they're like, "Thanks, mate, that's great, thanks for that, terrific." They didn't even really want to come, just bought the ticket for the wife, and then you had to go and do that. Shove it in my face, didn't you? Yeah. So, I grew up with four older brothers and sisters. How you guys doing? You good, over here? So I can touch you. So, I can touch you? Okay, good. I grew up with four older brothers and sisters. My youngest sister was born when I was 11, so for the first 11 years of my life, I was the youngest in my family, which everybody says is the best, right? Everyone says, "Oh, being the youngest, you're all spoiled, it's the greatest," and I'm like, let me hear from you if you're the youngest in your family. Oh yeah, I hear the grumbles. You hear those grumbles? Yeah. That's the middle kids, by the way. But it's not the best, it's the worst being the youngest. And I'll tell you why. Because your whole life, Everybody else is doing stuff that you're not old enough to do, right? And all they'll tell you, right, your whole life, this is all you hear. Don't worry, Hugh, it's okay. You'll get to do it next year or the year after. I'm like, next year or the year after? I'm 7. I'm going to punch you in the face. I am going to play the piano for you here today. Melbourne? Because clearly I think 3 years of piano lessons in high school qualifies you for playing arenas all around the world. Sorry to the lifelong professionals here. Life is completely unfair. Look at this, double spotlight, grand piano, in the dark. It's not fair. But we get paid the same, so it's sort of even better. Ish. Where was it? Oh yeah, being the youngest. So anyway, that is why I will never ever forget. I'll never forget the day of my first game of cricket when I was 8. I played cricket obviously in the backyard with my brothers, but this was a real cricket game. My own cricket team, my own cricket gear, my own cricket uniform. Biggest day of my life up to that point. And I'll never forget it. Everyone was out playing sport or being driven to sport, shopping, I can't remember. But I was told, make sure you're at the end of the driveway at 8:30. Another family's going to pick you up and your game starts at 9. So, great. So I'm sitting out there at the end of the driveway, like 6:30, waiting. And you know when you just know something's not quite right, but you don't want to admit it, right? You can feel something's wrong, but I was just sitting out there, it'll be okay. And I was waiting and waiting and waiting, and I didn't even want to go inside and check on the time because in case I was right, so I just stayed there sitting for, it seemed like forever. And finally, I had to go inside and check on the time, and it was 9:30, and I was freaking out because I thought, hang on a second, was it 9:30 and this is getting picked up, or maybe the phone's been ringing and I've been out there, I haven't heard it. So I started running backwards and forwards inside the house to the end of the driveway. Now it's 10 o'clock, now it's 10:30, 11 o'clock, and clearly I missed the game, and by 11 o'clock I just kind of gave up. I was just sitting out there so angry at the end of the driveway, waiting. Have you ever felt like nobody was there? Have you ever felt forgotten in the middle of nowhere? Have you ever felt like you could disappear? Like you could fall and no one would hear? Well, let that lonely feeling wash away. Maybe there's a reason to believe you'll be okay. 'Cause when you don't feel strong enough to stand, you can reach out your hand. And oh, someone will come running, and I know, take you home. 'Cause even when the dark comes crashing through, when you need a friend to carry you, when you're broken on the ground, you will be found. Let the sun come streaming in, 'cause you reach up and you rise again. If you only look around, you will be found. You will be found. You will be found. You will be found. That's not really a story of an 8-year-old boy missing his first game of cricket. I mean, sure, maybe somebody forgot to pick me up, or maybe it never happened, I don't know. But for some reason, that's the memory I have very clear in my mind. And I think it's because when I was 8, I was about as vulnerable as I'd ever been in my life. And I wish more than anything I could go back to that 8-year-old boy sitting at the end of the driveway and just reassure myself that everything will be okay, that yes, this feels terrible right now, and there's a lot going on right now you don't understand, but this will not define you. In fact, what will define you is just how many people will be there to pick you up when you fall. Come on!
ladies and gentlemen, the Australian Girls Choir and the National Boys Choir of Australia.
The National Boys Choir of Australia. They look like they could play the All Blacks tonight. Some of them. I said to them, you guys don't look like boys. And they said, ex-boys. I love that song. That song was written by Justin and Benj, who wrote all the music for The Greatest Showman. And it's from a musical called Dear Evan Hansen. Anyone heard of that musical? It's an amazing musical. I think it's coming here next year. Check it out. I've seen it 3 times. I absolutely love it. It's amazing. Speak of kids. Kids, these days, I know they have a lot of posters on their wall, right? You put up posters of your sports stars, rock stars, music stars, reality stars, whatever they are. But I never had that when I was growing up. When I grew up, I just had a map of the world next to me, pinned up right next to my bed. I used to lie in bed every night just dreaming of all the places I would get to go to when I was old enough. And, well, actually, that little bit of a white lie. I did have a poster of Olivia Newton-John on my wall for about a year. In the Let's Get Physical era. Yes, I kissed that poster a lot. And on the theme of care for what you wish for, check this out. So that's my wife, that's Olivia. Olivia, my wife. You might want to check what posters are on your kids' wall when you get home tonight. Take that poster of Ozzy Osbourne down right now. But anyway, by the time I turned 18, I just couldn't wait to travel. I just went off. I went on a gap year, traveled around Europe and England, and then I became an actor, which is basically being a gypsy, right? So you're on the road all the time, and I love it. I absolutely love it. But if you're a theater actor at heart, which I am, there's 2 places on your bucket list you have to go to. One of them is the West End in London, where I was lucky enough to be part of the Royal National Theatre production of Oklahoma in 1998. And thank you. The other one, probably even more special for me, because I was part of a musical called The Boy from Oz, which was the first Australian musical ever to play on Broadway. Start spreading the news. I'm leaving today. Make a brand new start.
singing, best audiences. Don't post that, I get in trouble. It is the best. Okay, the greatest showman. So the greatest showman took us like 8 or almost 9 years to get made, from the beginning to us actually releasing the movie. And we did a number of workshops over the years to just, you know, convince the studio. We would just bring him in every 18 months or so, show him what we had, what songs, etc. The very final workshop was in New York City. All the studio heads were there. And that's where the song This Is Me was sung for the very first time. And it was only sung then because it was only written 2 days before, literally on the way to that workshop on a red-eye flight. Look up there. That's Justin. Look at the little Casio keyboard up the top. He's writing the music, and Benj below writing the lyrics on his computer. And it was sung on that day at the workshop by Kiala Settle. And Kiala had been involved with every single workshop right up to that point. Oh, by the way, there is a video of her singing it at this workshop. It has currently been viewed by 42 million people. And if you haven't seen it, you must see it. It's one of the best things you'll ever see. Don't watch it right now, though. Maybe in the awards later. And just because you're in the workshop doesn't mean you're going to be in the movie. In fact, often it works the other way around. Often what happens is, you know, use Broadway stars to do the workshop, and then the last second they'll just insert a movie star. And because the movie stars don't want to do all the workshops, right? So Kiala had done every single workshop, and for me, she was the heart of that movie. Like, the moment you meet Kiala, I literally, the day I met her, I hugged her, and I came back and I said, I don't even know you, and I love you. Like, she's one of those people, just all heart, so courageous, just walking the talk of being true to herself every single day of her life. She's a real inspiration to me. Anyway, so she gets up and she sings a song. Now, what she did not know that day was that there are three major actresses, stars, in Hollywood were all campaigning to play the part. Now, of course, the head of the studio knew that. But by the time she'd finished singing that song, just standing ovation, not a dry eye there in the room, and the head of the studio runs across the stage, hugs Kiala, and says, you just booked your first major motion picture. Ladies and gentlemen, alongside my incredible company to sing This Is Me, please welcome Kiala Settle!
When the sharpest words wanna cut me down, This is bruised. This is who I'm meant to be. This is me.
Thanks to the man of this concert, Hugh Jackman. Yes. Come on, for giving me the opportunity to be here. And I'd also like to share something special with you guys tonight. For the past year and a half, I've been creating, writing, and recording what has become and what will be my first album for artists. And tonight, I'd like to sing a song from there that I haven't sung anywhere except here in Australia. And the song is titled Harder.
Stay with me, don't hang up the phone, listen carefully. I know it feels like you wanna leave. This world can be so lonely, yeah, I've been there too, just like you. Right now everything hurts, and it's just gonna get worse, get worse. Both knees at the cold ground, and you just wanna break down, break down. That's when you get up and you fight.
Yeah. To say you gave him this.
That is right. But my friend, you left so early. Surely something slipped your mind.
You forgot.
I gave these also. Would you leave the best behind?
Monsieur, release him. This man has spoken true.
I commend you for your duty. Now God's blessing go with you. But remember this, my brother. See in this some higher plan. You must use this precious silver to become an honest man. By the witness of the martyrs, by the passion and the blood, God has raised you out of darkness. I have saved your soul for
my shame inside me like a knife. there another way to go? I'm reaching, but I fall, and the night is closing in as I stare into the void, to the world of all my sin. I'll escape now from that world, from the world of Shabalshan.
Shabalshan is nothing now. Another story must begin.
For some more numbers, that's the end of Act One. Check out the screen.
Yeah.
original song, Break Back That Cabin.
I want to thank the air traffic controller. And I found myself like out the clock between the moon and New York City. Thank you. Hi to everyone in Australia.
Do you like your love in the dark?
In a musical goes to Hugh Jackman.
To Peter Allen, you wrote this song called Making Every Moment Count. You did it. You did it on stage and off stage. Peter, it's an honor to play you, and I dedicate this Tony to your memory.
Wearing the same thing as me. Pretty close. Pretty darn close. Stand up for a second. You have very good fashion sense, you know that. I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, is he or isn't he? Well, it's true, I am Australian. I'm used to feel so good. I'm a stranger now in the neighborhood. I've seen the world at a faster pace. And I'm coming now from a different place. So I didn't look the same way to you. You got a lot of battery there. You want me to go down first? Oh. If you insist, sir. A few people with hip replacements are very jealous right about now. Hi, sweetheart. You're looking very sparkly too. Aren't you? Look at you. Look at you. You are sparkly all the way down to the tips of your toes. Mindy, Billy, hi Billy, and the hair, you might be dressed up as Zendaya's character. Do a little spin, can you do a little, yeah, look at that, the whole thing. Let's hear it for Billy. Thank you for coming. Oh, we're all back from getting, you got all your snacks, everyone's got snacks, hi, you make snacks. Hi there, sweetheart. Nice to see you. Where was I? Oh, I was here. And you're videoing me. I've just been down there. Do you want me to go to... Okay, all right. There we go. How's that? Is my my little director over here. Give me that. Can I have that, Armando? I have a little choreographer here. You're my choreographer. What's your name?
Robert.
Hello, Robert. How are you?
Pleasure to meet you.
It's nice to meet you, too.
I can't sing.
Or shave, apparently. It's okay. I can say it. You look lovely. Although you started to sweat a little bit there. You can't dance at all. Who are you here with?
My wife, Vicky.
Hello, Vicky. Is it true he can't dance?
Yes.
You've never seen him dance?
Oh, yes, I have.
It wasn't pretty?
No,
Where was it? At your wedding?
Yes.
Oh. How long have you guys been married?
43 years.
43 years. He can't not dance for 43 years. Mate, he's like, mate, come with me. Come with me. Like you've been dancing all the time with your own band playing for you. And he's like, okay, I've had better. So you danced 43 years. I've already forgotten your name. I hate it when I do that. What was it?
Robert.
Sorry, Robert. You know, sometimes it just goes, I was just so mesmerized by your eyes.
Not my hair.
What's that?
Not my hair.
I love your hair. I love it. It's very nice. Don't feel bad about your hair. This is you. This is who you are. I can see you put a lot of care and attention into it. Please, oh, you want to go? I don't blame you. Can I get a hug, Robert? Yeah, go on. Oh, you're about to waltz me then. Let's hear it from Robert. First time dancing in 43 years. We make miracles happen here. 5, 6, 7. Give a big round of applause for my girls. Sorry, Seamus, I know I'm meant to be speaking on this one. Oh, Robert. I noticed your shoes there, Robert. More like hiking boots. Are we going to go on a hike together after? I'm open. I'm free. Yes, I am. Robert, you're a good sport, and that video is going to haunt you now the rest of your life. All right, I thought I might sing you some of my hit songs. I have to say hit in case you've never heard of them. I think you'll know this first one, though, because I won an Oscar for it. Too late, Melbourne, too late. Just once in your life, you'll find him. Someone who turned your heart around, and next thing you know, you're closing down the town. Wake up and it's still with you, even though you left Robert way across town, and you're wondering to yourself, hey, what have I found? Where do you get caught between the moon and New York City? Crazy, but it's true. If you get caught between the moon and New York City, the best that you can do is fall in love
me cry the day the circus came to town. But she didn't want parades just passing by her. So she painted on a smile and took up with some clown. And she danced without a net upon the wire. I know a lot about her, 'cause you see, baby, is an awful lot like me. Next song turned me from being a sensitive singer-songwriter into a sensitive singer-songwriter with a fabulous beach house. Thank you, Olivia. We love you, Olivia. We love you, we love you, we love you, Olivia Newton-John. Well, maybe I hang around here a little more than I should. We both know I've got somewhere else to go. But I've got something to tell you I never thought I would. But I believe you really ought to know. I love you, Melbourne. This next song I wrote for Judy Garland. I was at a cabaret performance of hers not long before she died, and she was singing, and there was a table in front of me speaking so loud throughout the entire show, I just couldn't take it any longer, right through her telling stories, right through her singing. So I just wrote down on a napkin, "Quiet please, there's a lady on stage," and I placed it on their table. Quiet please, there's a lady on stage. She may not be the latest rage, but she's singing, and she means it. And she deserves a little silence. Quiet please, there's a woman up there, and she's been on us through her songs long before your consciousness was raised. A little praise. So put your hands together and help her along. All that's left are the singers, all that's left are the songs that stand for the ovation. Give her one last celebration. Put your hands together, yes, I'm very long. All that's left are the singers, all that's left are the songs. Here we go, come on. Put your hands together. Not very long. Come on, let's get down to sing.
backing this amazing orchestra, ladies and gentlemen. Led by the one and only Patrick Vaccariello. While you're clapping, could you also put your hands together for Lara Young, who's saying I dreamed a dream at the end of that time? I love Melbourne. Okay. Peter Allen. Peter Allen was obviously an icon here in Australia, also in America. And I don't know if you know this, but he sold more consecutive sold-out shows at Radio City Music Hall than anyone in history. One of the great entertainers of all time. But mainly I always think of him as a storyteller because I think he told the most beautiful stories in his songs. And my favorite Peter Allen song, The Story, and I know I'm not alone here today, is Tenderfield Sadler. To help me perform it, would you please welcome a man who has been on the road with me for 16 years, an amazing guitarist, Mr. J.J. McGeehan. So Peter, I know a lot of you will already know this, I just don't want to assume it. So Peter grew up in a small country town in New South Wales called Tenderfield. And he grew up with the name of Peter Wallno. Wallno was his surname. He later changed it to Allen when he got into show business. And Tenderfield Sadler is a very simple but powerful song, which I think it's a very honest song. It tells the story of his life. It also tells the story of his troubled father's life. And at the very beginning of the song, of his grandfather's life. George Wallno worked on High Street and lived on Manors. For 52 years he sat on his veranda and he made his saddles. And if you had questions about sheep or flowers or dogs, you just asked the saddler. He lived without sin. They're building a library. Time is a traveler, ten of them saddle, I turn your head. Ride again, jackaroo, think I see kangaroo up ahead. The son of George Wallno went off and got married and had a war baby. But something was wrong, and it's easier to drink than go crazy. And if there are questions about why the end was so sad, well, George had no answers about why his son ever had need of a gun. Time is a traveler, ten of them saddle up to think I see kangaroo up ahead. The grandson of George has been all around the world and lives no special place. He changed his last name and he married a girl with an interesting face. It almost got in a life that leads, there's no place for George and his library or the son with a gun to belong, except in his song. Time is a traveler, Tenderfield saddle or turn your head. Ride again, jackaroo, you gotta see kangaroo.
back home my own. Through the dark, through the door, through when no one's been before, but it feels like home. They can say it all sounds crazy. They can say I'm lost my mind.
Dreams are really powerful, aren't they? Right? Not a person here tonight, today, who doesn't have a dream. But what goes with dreams are dragons. Those dragons, they guard the treasure. Well, for me, growing up here in Australia, one of my dreams was to be in a movie musical one day, right? My dragon was, how on earth can a kid from Tarramurra ever possibly be in a movie musical? But I used to just, someone from Tarramurra, right? But I used to love watching those musicals when I was growing up. I'm talking about the classics. I'm talking Gene Kelly, Fred Astaire, Ginger Rogers, like the classics, right? Love them. And they always used to do the reruns on a Saturday afternoon when I was growing up. Now,
I've seen a bunch of kids here today, and this is going to be difficult for you to even hear, but I grew up, I had a very difficult upbringing here in Australia. We only had four channels on the television. Laughing or uncomfortable, I think. But I used to play rugby, cricket, whatever, high jump, or whatever I was doing on a Saturday morning, and I'd come home and I'd just shove three meat pies down my face in 30 seconds, and I'd just flop down on the couch and I'd turn on the telly. And you know what? You couldn't even do that back then. You actually had to turn the television on first, then sit down, because there was no remote controls, kids. You actually had to watch the commercials. Or we were too lazy, so we watched them. Oh boy, but I remember I'd just flop down on the couch and that iconic theme music would start up. You're on this date with me, the pickings have been lush, and yet before the evening is over, you might give me the brush. You might forget your manners, you might refuse to stay. It's all the best that I can do. Luck be a lady tonight. Luck, have you ever been a lady to begin with? Luck be a lady tonight. Luck, let a gentleman see how nice a dame you can be. I know the way you treat other guys you've been with. My luck be a lady.
Yes! Yes! Let's hear it for Zach!
exactly as I taught you. That was amazing. All right, if I point you, I just want you to say, I got, Robert. Yeah, that's okay, a little quicker on the day, but that's a good start. Up there. Yes. Yes. You're too late, you weren't even paying attention. Very good. Good on you, buddy. Up the back. Yeah, I see you. Up there. Melbourne, they were already 9 minutes ago. Okay, here we go. Ready, Robert? Here it comes. Rhythm of the music. My hourglass or anything more. Daisies in green pastures. Yes. My hourglass or anything more. Feeling the rhythm in Melbourne. It's cold outside, but it's hot in here. Come on, click with me if you're feeling it. You know you're feeling it. This is Melbourne. This is a sexy city. Yes, I see you clicking. I love that. Yeah, you don't have to click, man. That's fine. No. She's like, I pay for the ticket. You do the entertaining, pal. We got so much rhythm in this band of you. This is a point in the show where I randomly select someone from my band. You can see the ones who are looking away from me right now. Hi, Nick. Hey, Nick on the trombone. It's Nick on the trombone, everybody! Sorry, Lara. Let me to push you back here. How are you, mate? You good? Which city are you from originally? Oh, he is from Melbourne! Now, what age did you pick up the trombone? At 10. And you picked it up because you thought that's going to be the easiest way to pick up, right? It's a common thing. A lot of people pick up the trombone thinking, this will really impress someone. But it's a sexy instrument, underestimated. You're about to hear right now just how sexy and how underestimated the trombone historically has been. No pressure. This is it. Ready? Listen to this. Come on. Oh. Yeah. Second date. Here we go. Ooh. Oh, loving this. Oh, he's on a roll. Take us all the way home. Take us home, Nick. Let's go. Well, the baby, 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 the
was in the fifth grade, I was about 9 years old. I was in a school concert, and the teacher who was in charge pulled me aside at the end and said, "You have talent as a dancer. You should go and take dancing lessons because they don't do them here at the school." So I went home and I asked my dad, "Is it okay if I get dancing lessons?" And he was like, "Yeah, of course." My dad was always very encouraging with things we wanted to learn. Anyway, my brother, who was about 10 at the time, he overheard and he started calling me a sissy. And I'm like, "What do you mean? I'm not a sissy." And he goes, "Yeah, if you're gonna be a dancer, you're a sissy because all dancers are sissies." So unlike Billy Elliot, I didn't get dancing lessons. And I kind of forgot all about it until I was 18 and I was going to see 42nd Street with my brother and my dad. And at the interval, my brother came up to me and said, "I said something really stupid to you years ago and I'm really sorry, but you belong up on that stage." And the very next day, I took my first tap class.
Let's cook this in. Come on. Quite Nadia Comaneci, but okay, so no offense to 42nd Street, that's a classic music, I get it, but I'm telling you, my whole life would have been completely different if at age 9 I'd walked past any dance studio anywhere in the world and heard this. Here we go. Come on in here. Here we go. The kids dress up as Shamrock, like, what is going on? What's going on? I see the Wolverine fans. I see them. They're like, finally, something. Hey, Cam Brendan, let's see Ryan Reynolds do that. But don't post that. No, I'm trusting you. I'll have 6 million tweets in the next 5 seconds. Trust me. Oh, man, thank you for letting me live out my all my dreams there, my nine-year-old dreams, right here on Rod Laver Arena. It's pretty cool. Rod Laver Arena. I was just thinking, like, almost every sports stadium in the world is named after whoever sponsors them, but Melbourne goes, no, let's name it after a legend. Let's just have that. So, when I was about 19, I was moping. I was on this break from uni. Well, all uni's a break, let's be honest. It was an official break, summer break, and I was heartbroken. My girlfriend had just dumped me, and thank you. I got over it. It's okay. About 3 years ago. No, I'm kidding. And. But my mate rang me and he's like, Jacko, you're not going to do this all summer. We're leaving tomorrow. We're going to the outback. We're going to build an indigenous community. We got a job on an indigenous community building some houses. And I went out the next day for 3 months. And those 3 months literally changed my life because there is something so magical, so spiritual about the outback of Australia. It's incredible. If you haven't, maybe you're from overseas, or if you haven't been out there and you don't have time to go out there, just watch a movie called Gurumul. Gurumul, a documentary. It's an incredible movie. If you haven't seen it, please watch it. If you ever want to get that feeling of what it is like to be in the outback, you get it in that movie. And there's a word in the Kimberley region, Lian is the word, and it means spirit. Spirit of a time, of a people, of a place. And in that 3 months, it was like that Leon got into my bones and has never left, to be honest. Sometimes I feel it's stronger than others, but I was just so sad the day I had to leave because I was the happiest I'd ever been in my life. And all that 19-year-old angst, all that worry about what I was going to do with my life, everything, even the heartbreak, everything just dissipated. And I remember coming home in the plane. I was crying the whole way home. And look, of course, I'm thrilled I came back. So much has happened in my life that never would have happened if I'd stayed out there in Arianga, like being with you all here today in Melbourne. I mean, it's incredible. I lived a life I never dreamt possible, but I think on some level I'm probably still searching and wanting to feel that Leon that I felt when I was out there for that 3 months sleeping under the stars. Honestly, at times, it's difficult to tell if you're still awake or if you've already started to dream.
Ooh, 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 Thank you.
Library, Paul Dawn, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you. Firstly, I'd like to acknowledge that we are standing on the traditional lands of the Wurundjeri Woi-wurrung tribe. I'd also like to pay tribute and respect to their elders, past, present, and future. I also realized yesterday that for 9 years, as we've traveled the world together, it's been my privilege to share the stage with these four great artists and musicians. I have been calling them by the name I was introduced to them, you know, Olive and Nate and Clifton, but they're not the names they were actually born with. So I'm just going to take a second now, but I'd love for you guys to introduce yourselves with your real name.
Hi, Melbourne. Nathan Munterby from Queensland. My language name is Midden from the Yurrbal tribe. And it means possum.
Hi, Melbourne. My name is Kangawar Nagara from the Bunuba, Walmajeri, and the Gunyani tribe of Fitzroy Crossing.
I'm actually her son. Also, Bunoba. My name is Jabanaka Berendari.
Good luck with this one.
So Hugh and I represent the non-Indigenous part of this collaboration. My name is Paul Boone and I'm a proud Dockers supporter.
Clearly the Dockers aren't doing it. When anyone in Melbourne claps, it clearly means you're not a threat this year. We have travelled the world together for 9 years. We represent an organisation called Nomad Two Worlds. It seems we live in an increasingly divided world. What we wanted to bring today and what Nomad is all about is the idea of reconciliation through culture, through music, through art. That's what we wanted to share with you today. Is an elder to the Aboriginal people. She is a mother to a nation, and she sat directly opposite our Prime Minister in Parliament House in 2008 when our country finally and formally apologised to the Aboriginal people. And Olive was speaking during that piece in her native Walmajari language. Not sure my pronunciation is right there, but it's okay. 6 out of 10. How do you say Walmajari? Walmajari. Walmajari. But I would love to ask you, Olive, to translate for everyone what you were saying.
The land is crying for its people, and the people are crying for the land. Do not be silent. Speak up for her.
And Olive, that last bit, that little bit at the end.
I had a dream, and my dream has come true.
Thank you. Olive Knight, Nate Possum Munterby, Dr. Library, and Paul Boone. Oh, that shark bit has such teeth, dear. And it shows them curly white. Just a jackknife has all my teeth. Hey, come on, and he keeps it out of sight. Yes, yeah. Oh, and that shark bites with his teeth in. Scarlet billows start to spread. Fancy claws all has all my teeth in. So there's never, never, never a trace of red. Come on, on that sidewalk,
wakes up on Sunday morning, as a body just losing life. There's someone is sneaking around that corner. Could it be our boy, Mac the Knight? Did you hear about Louis Miller? He disappeared, baby, after drawing out all his hard cash. And back he spends like a sailor. Could it be our boy, and it's got Sunday kind of rest? Put your hands together for the man, ladies and gentlemen. The strings. Yes, JJ on guitar, Mark on the bass, Brian on the drums, Jim on the piano, the one and only Patrick Agriello.
Numbers. Sometimes numbers actually help me. Oh, almost forgot. Two songs to go before the end. If you want to, now's the time to do it. Let me just get a drink. I'll turn my back so my feelings don't get too hurt. Thank you. Sometimes numbers help my mind expand, not contract. Like if I think about this universe being 13 billion years old, and that right now we are hurtling through space at 107,000 kilometers an hour. We're spinning right now, 1,600 kilometers an hour. And I'm just one of over 7 billion people on this planet. I mean, we're just specks in the history of time and the future of time. We're just specks in this infinite, beautiful, miraculous, complicated, challenging universe that we live in. But there's one thing I have learned in my first 50 years on this planet, is that you really can't measure your life with numbers. But if you're going to measure it, you measure it with people. Because on that, and on that front, I've just been so unbelievably blessed. And I just want to take this opportunity on behalf of everyone involved with the show to thank each and every one of you for buying the ticket, for being here today, for getting the babysitter, paying for the parking, paying for the lunch, the tram, the train, however you got here. It means the world to us that you decided to come. So thank you, each and every one of you for being here. Thank you. Even those people that are almost in the car park, thank you. Row, row, row your boats gently down the stream. Merrily, 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 life is but a dream. I drank champagne with kings and queens. Politicians praise my name. Come on, let's get up and dance, mother. Let's dance, sister. The walls of someone else's dream. Come on. Keep pause on the man I became. For years and years, I chased and chased. Praise me, always needed more. But when I stop and see you here, I remember all this was for. From now on, and these eyes around me are blinded by the lights.
Australia. Bronte. Redmond. Allison Ingersoll. Zachary from New York City. Camille, Washington, D.C. Yes, Byron and Sally.
And our dance captain, Michelle.
It's good to know.